Hi everyone, Mike here. Brian Tatler has dropped into Lick Library to say hi. And I've been asked to throw some questions his way. Hi Brian.
Hi Mike.
Nice to meet you.
You too.
Okay, question number one. Here we go. When did you first pick up the guitar? What made you interested in the guitar? And how old were you? And who was it that influenced you to pick up the guitar?
I had an older brother. Well, I've still got an older brother. He's 6 years older than me. And he played guitar. And he went to see Black Sabbath at Birmingham Town Hall in 1971 and decided to buy an electric guitar. So there was always electric guitar in the house. And he used to show me things. So that was useful to have an older brother around who could, you know, influence.
Is he any good nowadays?
No, I took over.
And he realised how hard it was.
Yes, probably.
And
let me do all the hard work.
What was that first guitar he bought that got you?
Well, it was just a cheap £14 homemade body guitar with a like a Fender Strat neck, but not Fender, and like an SG body, sort of stuck together with weird looking single coil pickups.
Okay, so how old?
But it did the job.
How old were you then?
I was probably about 11 then when he bought that guitar.
Right.
But I didn't really want to learn at that stage, so I'd have a little go, and then I'd figure it's too hard, and you know, he's tried to show me the bar chord, and I thought, no, that's
so too. Your brother was at the bar chord stage.
Yeah,
that's good.
He was at the bar chord stage.
He was pretty good,
and he wanted to teach me, and show, you know, he said this is an important chord, you're going to need that, and I used to say it's too hard, I can't be bothered with that, you know. So years went by, and I didn't seriously get into it till I was probably about 15, and one of the influences behind me wanted to play lead guitar really was Richie Blackmore with the old Highway Star guitar solo.
Right.
So once I heard that, I thought, actually, I'd like to be able to play like that.
Right.
And I'd like to be able to play that solo.
Right.
So, I started trying to play properly and put a lot of hours in.
Did you have any lessons from anybody?
No, other than my brother, really. You know, I'd occasionally go, how do you play this? How do you play that? I didn't really know any good players or guitar teachers around by where I lived. And somehow, it's not like it is today. There seems to be a lot of teachers and, you know, there's things like, you know, Lick Library.
Yeah, there's a lot of information out there.
Internet.
Did you and your brother jam, sort of?
Yeah, we did a bit of jamming.
Because that, even that would help someone if you're learning, wouldn't you? If you've got someone to play with.
Yes.
That really, I remember that really helped me.
Absolutely, and I used to slow things down. You know, we had a reel-to-reel tape recorder.
Oh, high tech.
Yeah. And I'd put the record player on, it had a 16, as did, so you could put an album on at 16, and it'd be all not too low. But you could figure out the licks very slowly. And so I tried to copy, you know, people like Jimmy Page and Paul Kossoff and all the great players that were around at the time with the aid of this tape recorder. And you know, as I say, with Highway Star, we really wanted to be able to play that, but it was double tracked, that was, and I didn't know what double tracking was when I was a kid. So it was impossible to play with one guitar anyway, really, that is. And it's a harmony and different things.
Yeah, yeah.
So no wonder I could never get it. You know? I spent years trying to get that solo.
What was the first decent piece of kit you bought, the first decent
guitar?
Yeah, I
bought a Fender Strat, because again, like Blackmore, I wanted to be a bit like Blackmore. So I went out and bought like a sunburst finished Fender Strat with a rosewood neck.
So that would be like, what, 1976? So it was a 76 Strat?
I don't know if it was brand new, it might have been second hand.
Even better, so it's a pre-75 Strat?
Yes, it might have been.
And you
it
sold
might have
been
a 73.
You sold that years ago, didn't you?
Of course I did. Because I didn't know what it was.
See, now that would
and
be a
I
really
didn't
cool
have enough
guitar,
power because it had single coils in it.
Yeah, yeah.
I wanted.
They were particularly weak pickups back then.
Yeah, I wanted I realised that now I wanted a humbucker. And so it took me a little while to realise that I needed a humbucker rather than a single coil.
What about amp wise and stuff like
that? I think I just had a Marshall. But I don't know which one it was. I think my brother, again, was useful for telling me what you need to get is a Marshall amp and a Marshall cab. At one of these pedals and stuff like that.
Yeah.
So I remember having a Laney cab and a Marshall amp, but it was probably just maybe the four input type. And then I did have a master volume which came out around 75, I think. Yeah, yeah, so yeah. That'd have been just time for me.
Yeah.
So of course you could have your amp up quite loud in quiet in your bedroom rather.
With some gain and some distortion. So, if I've got my facts right, which I probably haven't, but if I have got my facts right, you met the guys from Diamond Head at school.
At school.
So yes. 15, you know, you're playing together
at school. Yeah, 15, really, all 15, going on 16. And we were just about to leave school. And I'd formed the band with our drummer, Duncan Scott. And we just had this guitar from Brothers. And I used to borrow his amp, and which was a Linear Concord 30 watt piece of shit, really. And Duncan had a biscuit tin drum kit.
Oh,
it was made out of an actual biscuit tin for the snare drum with the biscuits in that acted as a dampening device kind of thing. With a little chain taped on top. And then a black plastic wine making tub was the bass drum. And we had some sweet jars and little bits and bobs for the drum kit. And so that was set up in my bedroom. And we started the band kind of jamming and trying to write songs.
I bet that sounded really, really good.
I couldn't have never been able to emulate that sound since.
Did you get it on? Did you record it on cassette?
Yeah,
anywhere?
Of course you did.
Have you still got those cassettes? Bootleg, quick. That's fantastic. So, so all the guys were from school, and were they your friends kind of at school, and they just happened to have a talent, or did you become friends with them because they one, you know,
no.
had a biscuit tin kit and
well,
one could
yeah,
sing?
Yeah, Duncan. I pretty much persuaded Duncan. I think I was the one who wanted to. Do a band.
So you formed the band?
Yeah, so it was,
you
and it was my band, you know, my name, I thought of the name Diamond Head. So I probably talked Duncan into becoming the drummer. And Sean, the singer, was just another friend from school, but he wasn't a close friend. He was more, he played football and he was a bit more, you know,
right.
with the lads, a bit more into fashion. And
right.
So I was probably a bit more nerdy, if
right,
you
right.
like. And somebody heard him sing on a school coach trip. Yeah, to Paris, you know.
And this is rock and roll history here.
He sang Bebopalula on the school coach trip. And so somebody's ear must have pricked up and thought, oh, he can sing. Brian's looking for a singer. And we got together like that. So he came round my house and we jammed a little riff. And instantly I thought, that's it. Fantastic. Sean's the man. So that was it then.
And how did it get
three
from
piece.
How did it get from that stage to actually signing
a record deal?
Yeah, how did it? Because it was all
was
that new
years was, in between.
It was all that new kind of British metal.
New
thing.
Wave of British heavy metal.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay, well,
you've probably been asked this question a million times, but let's go over it. Come on, give us the story.
So the band was formed in '76, so of course it's 3 years before the new wave of British heavy metal came around in '79.
This is when punk was going on.
Yes,
like
well, punk was sort of '77, wasn't it? '76, '77, and that was an influence on me as well, because as I'd said before, I wanted to play like Blackmore, but I couldn't. So I thought, when I saw Steve Jones come on TV playing, you know, Pretty Vacant or something, I thought, I can play that. I can't play Harvest Time, but I can play that. So maybe we should just form the band and get on with it,
yeah.
and not sit in my bedroom for 15 years trying to become the, you know, one of the greatest guitarists of all time. Then just get on stage, you'll be all right.
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, and write some songs. And it was kind of a, you know.
It was a good philosophy, really.
Yeah,
it
I
really
think
was.
So. Punk rock.
Yeah.
Influenced a lot of bands. I mean, Sex Pistols and bands like that influenced a lot of people to pick up the guitar, didn't they? Or form bands and just get on with it, really.
The interesting thing about that Never Mind the Bollocks album is it still sounds great today.
Oh, yeah.
Put
it's
it on,
fantastic,
it just sounds.
Thomas.
Yeah, sounds awesome.
There's a lot of work went into it, though. I don't think it was done in a weekend or anything.
But they sold it as that. But
yeah.
It was
done in Wessex, so it was in a proper studio with a proper producer.
Yeah, it was nicely
EMI.
Done.
EMI.
Yeah.